So I'm here, really happy to welcome Romeo Kinsler. How are you doing, Romeo?
I'm fine. How are you?
I'm doing great. I can see that right now you're on the move, but hopefully you'll be ready actually to do the presentation right now.
Of
Is
course, of
everything
course. I'm not
awesome?
driving.
By the way, it's really important that you're not driving. If I'm not mistaken, you're right now live from Switzerland. How is it there?
Actually, to be really precise, I'm in Germany at the moment because there's a vacation period, and it's Black Forest, so I'm in the middle of snow.
Oh, this is at the same time might be marvelous, looks marvelous, but at the same time might be cold.
It's cold, yeah.
Yeah, but I really hope that you'll get like kind of for you'll get warmer talking about your topic. So please, once again, give it up to Romeo Kinsler. He's the Chief Data Science at IBM Center for Open Source Data and AI Technologies. And today you'll be talking for us about the Claint, which is a visual and scalable component library for trusted AI. Am I correct?
Yes, so I will clarify exactly what it is in my talk, but it gives you it's a good start.
Thank you so much. So please, be attentive, prepare your questions for Romeo. Romeo will be also back for our Q&A, of course, but right now, give it up to Romeo. The floor is yours if I also help you to share the screen.
Okay, so you should see my screen already. Is that true?
Yes.
Okay, so how much time do I have? 30 minutes?
You have approximately, yes, 30 minutes, yes.
Okay, and Q&A is
Maybe
afterwards, so.
maybe 35, something like this, like with a
Okay.
shifting of per minutes, but yeah, definitely.
Awesome. Okay, good. So let me
So the
start.
floor is yours. I will be
Thank you
back
so
later.
much.
Thank you.
Okay, so I hope you see my screen, full screen now. Actually, I'm giving you something which will only be public in like 2 weeks because I already created this presentation here for the IBM Think Conference. And the content is the same, so I just took the template. I hope you are okay with that. So I want to talk today about a library which we have created. It's called Claint, the component library for AI, machine learning, ETL, and data science. And it's just not something like an ordinary library. It's much more cooler. I will show you in a second, because the second title here, it's a Kubeflow low-code architecture. Okay, so you can basically track and drop components on a canvas and scale it on Kubernetes. Just a little spoiler here. And also, I have developed this together with an IBM client, the University Hospital of Basel in Switzerland. And there we have tackled computer vision pipeline for healthcare. And it's all based on CT scans of lungs in a COVID setting. Okay, and of course we have added some trusted AI components, which I'll show you later. Okay, so I will skip those disclaimers. They are not for this conference. So what I want to state is that 47 of all AI projects never leave the experimentation phase. Sometimes this is due to design, because a lot of AI projects are actually only for experimentation. So the final deliverable or the final goal is a publication or a model. This is fine. But there are a lot of others which actually have the potential to become part of a production process, but never end up there. And that is something we really want to address. So those numbers are changing depending what source you read, but actually I would say at least half isn't making it into production, maybe even worse. Okay, so the second thing is a lot of people don't trust how companies are using AI and data, and therefore anything which brings in transparency is good. If it's in the pipeline, the reproducibility, in the assessment of the model itself, or in trust on using data, that doesn't matter. But everything you can throw into the mix is actually helping us a lot here. Okay. Then I have read a T-shirt some years ago. Maybe you have been aware of this hype where people were saying, "Yeah, data is the new oil." That was in the, say, the data science machine learning hype. Then the AI hype began, and I just casted that into data is the new plutonium if you are using deep learning. And then some guy on a conference ran around with a t-shirt, data is the new tofu. So I really like that because it is just making jokes about this hype thinking. But anyway, I just put here trusted AI and MLOps is the new tofu. And this talk is here about MLOps and trusted AI. So we have defined some requirements with the client. Actually, that was an iterative approach, of course. So we didn't come up with these requirements at day zero. But let's say after working together for around 1 year, we have like defined those requirements. So what the client actually needs is a rapid prototyping environment using visual editing and also notebooks. So it's some no-code, low-code environment they need because they have people. So a lot of medical doctors are actually using this platform. They have no or only little programming skills. So anything which is already ready made. This is really what is happening here is also makes things simple. Scale, because we are here working with medical image data, so one scan easily can go into gigabytes. Okay, and that means during development already you need to scale. You cannot develop your algorithm on your laptop because it just takes too long. You want to push this, let's say, Jupyter cell, for example, to a server machine which has GPUs also, okay? And of course, during deployment, it's even more important. As I already mentioned here, GPU support is essential. And then another requirement is that all the ML tools and life science tools have to be supported. So the most prominent here in this scenario is DICOM. DICOM is a proprietary format for CT scan data, for example. And you need to somehow convert it to matrices or tensors to use in TensorFlow or PyTorch. And also, if you can convert it back, it's pretty handy because you can attach your findings into the DICOM container. There's a metadata section, so it's instantly accessible to the medical doctors afterwards, because then they can just use their DICOM viewers. The another thing is reproducibility. If data scientist A does something and then goes home and get hit by a car, for example, it has to be guaranteed that data scientist B can just take over his work and actually find out what he did, which data he has used, which algorithms, what software he has written, and which versions of the frameworks he has used. And of course, data lineage is also important. You need to know which data was involved in training a model or in creating a visualization. And then another requirement was this whole thing has to be in open source. It's okay to have a commercial offering around it, but the core architecture needs to be in open source. And then we also needed to add collaboration support because obviously a lot of people are working together also internationally, not only in this particular hospital, and also asynchronously and synchronously. Okay. So we have started with one tool. It's called Cloud Annotations, which we created in open source. It's a tool for annotating data. And we took the naive approach because we just thought drawing rectangles around objects is sufficient, but it turns out it isn't. So our next step is to allow the user to using deep learning models to create arbitrary shapes around objects on pixel level. No, that's actually what's needed. So we can use and continuously use the latest models to create the boundaries, and then the doctors can just adjust the boundaries. So it's going into the active learning direction. Then we have based this architecture on containers. So for those who don't know, Docker is a lightweight way of virtualization with super fast startup and tear down. And if you are talking about Docker, of course, the next thing you want to talk about is Kubernetes, which provides orchestration for those containers. Because if you can start and stop containers in milliseconds and hundreds of containers per node, you need to have a way to orchestrate those. And that's where Kubernetes kicks in. So Kubernetes can deploy containers, scale it, and also ensures high availability by transparently moving containers around the physical nodes. Then, as we already have such a cool Kubeflow environment, the next idea or next step is obviously to have AI and machine learning flows executed on top of Kubernetes. And that's actually what Kubeflow provides. So you have deployment, reproducibility, pipelines, also the capability of model serving and training at scale. Okay. So you have here on the right-hand side an example. Oh, let me just have some beeps here because of my power supply. Okay, so. So you have here on the right-hand side an example that Kubeflow actually gives you. So this is an example of executed pipeline. And you show the different intermediate steps you see for this image analytics pipeline. And also it supports branching out and in. And at the end of this pipeline, it deploys the model. So that's Kubeflow. Then let's have a look at Elira. Elira is another open source tool which is developed by my team. It is an extension to Jupyter Lab at the moment, but we are also currently working on supporting VS Code. And it has a couple of extensions, for example, for Git, and for example, to get a diff between two notebooks. But the most important feature, in my opinion, is the pipeline editor. So it allows you a no-code, low-code ML pipeline design by just dragging and dropping components from the left-hand side to the right-hand side. So those components include notebooks, shell scripts, and Python scripts at the moment. But I will show you later what's actually up in the queue. So those pipeline components are reusable. And also we can push those pipelines to local execution at the moment, or to Kubeflow, or also to Airflow. So we are constantly adding support for different workflow execution environments. So now I'm actually introducing the claimed library, the component library for AI, machine learning, ETL, and data science. So while we have been developing these pipelines, we identified at the moment around 40 reproducible steps, and those are granular steps, for example, transforming an image, training a model, assessing model quality. And the cool thing here is that each pipeline step is backed by a Jupyter notebook at the moment. So for the no-code part, you just drag and drop it, and you can open properties and set the properties as you are used to in any, let's say, visual data science tooling. At the same time, you can double-click the component and you are brought to the underlying Jupyter notebook in this case, where you can learn from how it is developed and at the same time also make changes. We already started to provide a couple of sample pipelines, and one of the pipelines is this healthcare pipeline for the CT scans of lung COVID cases. So I give you an overview of a couple of components which are supported in Kubeflow. So one is, for example, TFChop. So TFChop allows you to apply parallel training on TensorFlow, and it takes care on the distribution. So as this is now running on top of Kubernetes, you don't have to care about cycling up nodes and configured nodes. You can see here the training of a neural network in parallel is relatively simple. So what you do is you partition your data. In this case, in a three node example, you divide your data into three chunks, P1, P2, and P3. And then you train the model on the data chunk, and every now and then, so every couple of epochs or batches or whatever you take, you synchronize the weights. So in this case here, you synchronize the weights in a round robin fashion, but there are other options as well. And that's the way how parallel neural network training is done. But the cool thing here is TFChop does the job for you. So it's a component, and the only thing you need to specify is the number of parallel workers you want to train it. Okay. Another interesting type is the SparkChop. So you can make Apache Spark now a first-class citizen in Kubernetes using the SparkChop on top of Kubeflow. And again, here you just define the amount of parallelization, and Spark job component will take care of distributing your workload. And the very cool thing now is you can mix and match Spark and TensorFlow stages. So that means you have your parallel Spark job for data pre-processing, and afterwards you have a parallel TensorFlow job for deep learning model training. Another important component in Kubeflow is KTIP. KTIP is the hyperparameter tuning component. So what it allows you is using different algorithms. Maybe you've heard about grid search and Monte Carlo search and Bayesian optimization. There are some 3-4 others where KTIP actually searches through the hyperparameter space. As you can see here, LR stands for learning rate, and the number of layers and optimizer. It tells you, depending on what you choose for learning rate, number of layers and optimizer variant, you get different values for validation and training accuracy, and therefore you just choose a combination which maximizes those two. Okay. KTIP has a very nice user interface. There are other hyperparameter tuners out there, open source, for example, HyperOpt or RayTune, and we are also planning in integrating those. As everything is just backed by simple Python scripts and notebooks, and nothing else is needed, it's really straightforward to create those components for everybody then to use drag and drop style. Another interesting component here around trusted AI. So in trusted AI, you have different categories. You have adversarial robustness, you have explainability, and also bias or fairness assessments. So with respect to explainability, IBM open sourced the AIX 360 toolkit. And in this case, we are just delegating to the LIME algorithm. And the LIME algorithm actually simulates or tries to find out at what regions of an image a deep learning algorithm looks at. I mean, it's not limited to deep learning, but let's say a model. At what regions of an image a model looks at, it does this by basically just permutating the input data, so the image, until you get a misclassification, and that way creating a heat map. So you see here on the right hand side, the algorithm is looking at a certain region of a bone, and then for a doctor, this is important to notice. So if it's, for example, around lung disease, it's a bit fishy to see the area of interest at the bone, but if it's on bone fractures, then of course it's really making sense if the algorithm is looking at bones. Okay. Then we have adversarial robustness. So it's all about how an AI model can be fooled by either poisoning the model itself or by poisoning the data. But another area is also called extraction, where you extract parts of the training data. For example, you could extract parts of the images which have been used for training the model. And this library actually tackles this problem by detecting possible vulnerabilities in your models. Then the third pillar in trusted AI is fairness, so or bias detection. For example, in the healthcare, I've just discussed it with a client, you have, for example, a biased training set. So you have a certain set of images, and a certain outcome for a treatment. So if, for example, this data is biased in favor of male, and this is present in the training data, and if you could classify an image based on what you see on the gender, which is actually possible, so a doctor can easily tell based on an X-ray or CT scan if this is a male or female, then AI model can do the same. Okay, so if you have biased training data and you don't disclose the gender to the algorithm, it still will come up with a latent hidden feature which represents gender at the end, okay? And that means the algorithm is not actually working properly. It just does some internal processing to find out the gender or the latent representation of the gender, and then uses this information to increase its performance. Therefore, it's important to detect whether this model is biased, and you do that basically by disclosing the gender to the bias detector but not to the model, and then it will come up with different indexes on bias where which the research community agreed on. For example, on the top right you see tail index, and tail index is pretty interesting because it gives you a number between 0 and 1, so it's normalized. And then it cannot only detect, it can also mitigate bias. That means it can change your data or it can change your model and decrease the bias. Most often, you are trading then accuracy of the model. Just a side note, all that open source stuff we are here creating, that's one of the purposes of our center, is provide this as a basis for our commercial product. So one example is here Watson OpenScale, which is a integrated solution for model quality assessment and constant monitoring. On the top right you see model monitors for the quality, and on the top bottom left you see, for example, a view on the bias. And all those components and libraries actually we just use. I just want here to state that the stuff we are here doing in open source actually finds the way into our products and to our clients. So it's like a round trip thing. Okay, so now we have this capability of creating a Kubeflow component out of Python script, shell script, or Jupyter notebook, attach it to a container image and compile it into a Kubeflow component. So we are currently in the process of releasing a data science asset repository, which takes models, data sets, notebooks, pipelines, but also Kubeflow pipeline components. So we can then compile this, and we have a central repository, for example, in your organization. We have also the plan of getting a open public one where people can just contribute their components and then they can be consumed. And on the consumer side, it's getting now interesting. On the right hand side, you see the commercial version of the tool. On the left hand side, the free and open source version. What you then get is on the left hand side, as you're used to in a no code or low code environment, you have a palette in different categories where you can just drag and drop components from left to right, put it to the canvas, connect it, and set some properties. But all the existing tools like Nime and Vika, and also the commercial ones like DataStage from IBM or Informatica, and all those tools, they have a limited set of components. They don't have a community behind the components. No, you can write extensions in R or Python and so on, but it's not something that you can import the component library. And I think this is the first time in history that we have an open source component library. That those are all scalable on Kubeflow, and also platform independent. So you can basically pull them into any low-code, no-code environment. And we are just here making the case for Elira on the open source side and Watson Orchestrator on the closed source side. So this is basically the final pipeline we have created for this university hospital, and they are currently, let's say, pimping it. So as you can see here, it's a little small, but you see there is a train mobile net. So it uses mobile net as a Hello World algorithm. But the university hospital has already created more sophisticated COVID-19 classification models, which they already published. So we are now integrating those into the pipeline and also making those part of the claimed libraries that everybody can just not only use it, but just drag and drop it. Okay. So it will open a lot of opportunities for folks which are skilled in their domain, but not so skilled in programming and data science. Okay, so to sum this up, we have created here a rapid prototyping environment supporting visual editing. That means you have the capability of dragging and dropping any component to the canvas. And I just say this again, the component at the moment is just based on Jupyter notebooks, Python scripts, or shell scripts. Those are compiled into Kubeflow components, and then they can be run at scale. What will happen in Elira version 2.3, we will support all Kubeflow components. Okay, so I'm just going for sake of understanding, because we have a couple of minutes. If my laptop lets me. Yeah, okay. Actually having a hard time, so okay, I'm going back to this slide here. Okay, see, now at the moment we just can create these Kubeflow components based on Jupyter notebooks, Python scripts, and so on, but the Kubeflow component is actually less demanding. So all a Kubeflow component needs to have is a container image and the YAML file. Okay, so what we will have in Elira version 2.3 is that we can just pull in any Kubeflow component into this canvas, and there are also there's a huge community of already existing Kubeflow components, and that actually will just further increase the usefulness of this library, because at the end of the day, everybody will be able to do data science by just dragging and dropping stuff on a canvas. Okay, so let's go back to the summary. So that's the rapid prototyping, visual editing aspect. Then the scaling. So we have scaling during development and deployment. So during development, you can do many things. You can, of course, create a pipeline during development, but this becomes a bit cumbersome. So we have two other solutions in there. First of all, you can also push a single notebook to Kubeflow. So what we there do is just create a Kubeflow component on the fly of, out of your Jupyter notebook, and push it into a single stage pipeline on Kubeflow. But what we also support is the so-called Jupyter Enterprise Gateway. And that's even cooler, because if you are in a Jupyter environment, usually you just have a local kernel. That means the same node which runs your Jupyter server just runs also the kernels. But with the Jupyter Enterprise Gateway, by the way, it's also open source and heavily used by IBM and outside IBM, you can select a certain specification and just create a kernel based on that specification. And the specification includes which version of Python you need, for example, how many CPUs or GPUs you need, and how much memory you need. And then you just select that required specification, and then Kubernetes will schedule a pod somewhere on the cluster. And the Jupyter Enterprise Gateway acts as a proxy between your Jupyter UI on the browser and the pod. So actually, the Jupyter environment on the browser thinks it talks to the Jupyter server, but in reality, it talks to a proxy, and the proxy just forwards this traffic to a randomly deployed pod, which then runs your kernel. And of course, during deployment, you have the option of deploying the pipeline to Kubernetes using Kubeflow. But in addition, for example, if you want to deploy a model, you can also use KF Serving, which runs on top of Knative, and out of the box, just push a model, a trained model, to Kubernetes as well. Okay. GPU support is easy because it's out of the box supported in Kubernetes. The only thing you need to make sure is you run in a container image which supports GPUs. Then the ML tools and life science tools, they are easily supportable. Anything you can run in a container, you can basically support. So that was straightforward. You just, if there is a PyPI package available or R package or whatever, we can support it, okay? Then reproducibility is supported through the nature of Kubeflow, because each pipeline you, for example, create in Elira and push to Kubeflow ends up to be a pipeline in Kubeflow. And if you run a pipeline, you get an experiment. So Kubeflow takes track on all the versions of your pipelines, plus it also keeps track on all the executions, the so-called experiments of your pipelines. And you can then cover data lineage, because you know which pipeline ran at what time, which version, and which configuration it had, and which source data set it touched, and which data sets it created. And therefore, you are always aware what data was involved in your pipeline. And if the pipeline creates a model, of course, you also are aware of what data was involved in creating this model. Okay, this whole stuff is, as I already said, open source. It's Elira, JupyterLab, VS Code, Kubeflow, Kubernetes. So that's pretty cool. And then collaboration support. So we use Git for collaboration. That's an easy support for cross-organization collaboration, because every organization can run their private instance of this reference architecture. And so there's no need on transferring this data sets between the organizations or in running on a central cloud instance. It can all be done locally or semi-locally. For example, if in Switzerland we have multiple organizations or hospitals working together, they share data centers. So all those scenarios are supported. And with the Elira tooling, for example, you also get Git integration for notebooks, where you can basically compare two notebooks with each other. Okay, that concludes my talk. I guess Q&A is later. So I wish you a happy day. And for those who are missing the talk, I will give it again around 10. PM Europe time for folks in US. Thanks a lot. Okay, I'm not sure what I'm supposed to do now. Maybe telling a joke. Okay, anyway, I'm just leaving. Then I see you later in the Q&A session.
Yeah, Rama. Thank you so much for your presentation. We'll see you in 40 minutes. Please join us. And more where we're going forward. And hopefully we find time.
Okay, bye. Thank you.
Thank you, bye.